Are you willing to donate your body? Got a problem with authority? Would you stop a speeding bullet? Are you afraid of the masked man?
Yeah, we do. Broadcasting live from the heart of Europe, you're listening to the most badass hockey podcast in all the known land. Ladies and gentlemen, I am Tommy C, and this is Shot from the Point Live. This week on Shot from the Point Live, the Flames deal Glencross to the Capitals. We'll be talking about that, all sorts of trade news, all the news of the week. Has been a very interesting week in the land of hockey. Going into March, going into the playoff stress, there's so many teams that are on the cusp. Obviously, this is more than likely going down to the wire right in the second week of April. And you two can listen to it. Right, Jake?
Right.
Yeah. Well, good response. Welcome back, douche. Yeah, that's it. You'll get all that and more from the guy who ruined Monetize This. Come on, let's do this. To my right or my left, depending on which end of the mirror you're looking at, none other than comedian legend, who's back after a two-week absence, comedian and legend Jake Link. Sitting in for the newsman, the blues man, one Jeff the Huff Huffman. Huffman is out probably scaring the hell out of 12-year-old children, screaming at them at the top of their fucking lungs and terrorizing them, chasing them away from the game of hockey. And for him, none other than the little more humble and the guy that probably would have gotten screamed at had he been coached by Matt Huffman, none other than Matty Isis Kazar. How are you doing, guys?
Hey, man.
Hey, what's happening?
What's going on? I'm happy to be back.
Yeah, it is. It has been a bit of a... It's been more than a minute. We started to forget you were around. Everybody holding down the fort over here for so long, and you're like down in Tampa. Doing whatever you had to do.
I was near Daytona, actually.
Oh, that was... I thought you were...
I'll tell you one thing. If you are not actively seeking out hockey...
Yeah.
You are completely lost. It is not... There's the ECHL team, the Orlando Solar Bears.
Uh-huh.
But other than that, there is, like, nothing to do with hockey.
I know.
It was so bad. I was wearing my Devil's jersey. I was at a poker room. And there was a guy. He must have been Jeff. He must have been Jeff Huffman's brother. Guy had on a blues hat, blues jacket. And he comes up to me. Why, hello there, fellow Devils fan. And I said, and he just, it just was kind of like, he was like, thank God, another hockey fan in this freaking hockey Siberia that it is Florida.
Yeah, you were like two Aboriginal guys from Australia that just happened to run each other in Puerto Rico, you know? Oh, we're the same tribe. No kidding. This place is crazy, right?
Yeah. And it was like, we're just sitting there talking about, because I think the Blues got like, this is that the day after they got killed in Dallas.
Oh, yeah.
So I was like, you guys looked like shit the other night.
All right. That being said, we're going to talk about all the trades. We're going to go quick over some of the trades this week, and Matt will be doing the news. He looks as nervous. Like, stop looking so nervous. Be a man. Be confident.
Oh,
I think his screen's
frozen.
Dem
said that Matt looks like a hot nerd.
He's all right. I mean, everybody's going to say I'm gay, but I don't care. Maybe I am. Matt, I think, is a good-looking guy. If he would be a real later killer if he had a Jeff Huffman's abs. you know.
This is a hockey show.
For some reason, Matt's screen is frozen. That happens to Dead on Dave every so often. But you know what? That picture's pretty good, so we'll just go with that. Before we start out, I want to go over some of the trades. Let's get the web view up here. Some of the last trades in That's the, you know, I'm really starting to hate the new XSplit situation. It's actually starting to get on my nerves a little bit. And yeah, for that reason, that sucks. What the hell is this? I can't show the trades? You ignoramuses. Jesus. I'm trying to get the trades up there on the board, and it doesn't seem like it's going to work. And it really bothers. Oh, there we go. Here's some of the trades. Some of the last trades, let's go all the way back to when things started breaking. I would say that would be February 26th. Jaromir Jagr heads to from the New Jersey Devils after complaining and whining and crying a little bit to the Florida Panthers to help their playoff drive. Everybody says that this Jagr couldn't be happy about the situation because, you know, let's face it, Panthers' shots at Stanley Cup are slim to none. But I think, Lou's going to do what's best for Lou. Lou Lamoriello, that is, the general manager of the New Jersey Devils. Is there any living in New Jersey, Jake, is it like what's the overall feeling about this trade?
You know what? I think the overall feeling is actually mixed emotions. It's, mm-hmm. Some people are like, oh, he should have stayed. And,
yeah.
And I think it's kind of more or less it's the writing's on the wall for mm-hmm. the season.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And, for a lot of people, you still got 20 games to play.
Mm-hmm.
So you still got to keep on playing them.
Sure.
And, you're still in this. The 1% chance that they have left, you're still in this race.
Mm-hmm.
So, but let's face it. Jagr is... He's 42 years old.
Mm-hmm.
He's contract to contract. The fact that you got a third round pick and also a pick to be named later.
Yeah.
A conditional pick.
Well, you got a second round pick and then the conditional's the third round.
Yeah, the fourth conditional round, third round.
So the second round pick is the worst. Second round pick is worth
it. I think the Devils made out great.
Yeah. Typical Lou making something out of nothing. I would like to see, as a fan, like to see Jagr get a team that had a better shot than the Panthers.
That's what I'm shocked about too. He has old aching bones and just like
it's not
just like everyone
him.
Else.
It's
you
not
go to Florida when you're when you're getting old. So.
It's not a, it's yeah he's going down to Florida to retire. Yeah, but it's it's like it's not up to him. Lou's going to do what Lou's going to do. Let me go on to some of the other trades. Probably the biggest one, in my opinion, was the David Clarkson for Nathan Horton. The interesting one goes Clarkson from the Leafs Clarkson goes from the Leafs to the Blue Jackets. Nathan Horton, who we basically thought was written off, was actually involved in the trade. He goes to the Maple Leafs. This was obviously done. Nathan Horton more than likely will never play again. This was obviously done for cap reasons, and I think Columbus sort of wins this deal because they get to pay for the guy that actually plays. Clarkson actually fits into their kind of rough and tumble style, so it's not a bad deal. Nathan Horton may get another chance, but I don't know, and I'm not a doctor, and I don't know about degenerative back issues. But from my understanding, Nathan Horton's done. God, I hope I'm wrong. But it just doesn't. It's just really simply a cap move. This was shocking to me. Kimmo Kiinnanen, he hits the lottery and more with Kimmo Timonen of the Philadelphia Flyers. He ends up in Chicago. He gets a second round draft pick for him. This is a guy that had blood clots, life threatening issues, and he's going to get a shot to play with the Blackhawks. Now that's great, and what a nice thing to do for Philadelphia, and they get a second round draft pick. But I don't understand the move. From Chicago, and I don't know why they would be so confident for
Johnny Oduya is hurt.
They're really rolling the dice. It almost feels like a panic move.
There's also some rumors about the Devils dealing Mike Camilleri
mm-hmm.
and also possibly Patrick Elias to the Blackhawks because of Patrick Kane going down.
What do you think about Elias going? Oh, God, if you thought Martin Brodeur was weird being a St. Louis Blue, can you imagine Elias being a Blackhawk?
You know what it is? I mean, right now it's all business.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And if you could get draft picks for Patrick Elias, if you could get a second-round pick
mm-hmm. –
Patty, thank you for everything you've done.
Mm-hmm.
It's time to rebuild. It's time to get these picks. It's time to, it's time to get ready for the future.
No, so. He hits a great point because I found it really weird. We're going to get into some of the trades later, but
mm-hmm.
don't you find it weird how they were saying that this draft is supposed to be like one of the best drafts in the past few years?
I've been hearing that for the last 2 years.
Giving away their picks so casually.
Yeah, I guess. So maybe a second round pick is actually worth more than a second round pick in past years.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah, I don't know. Look, I don't know enough about the juniors.
That's funny you say that, distinction,
but I'm going along with the experts. Yeah, I guess it's a good draft pick, and it's usually when you have a player of Connor McDavid's quality, for just some bizarre reason, the rest of the lineup seems to be deep too. I'm sure there's a guy that's going to go in the first round that we don't know too much about that's going to be an instant star like Nathan MacKinnon was on the Colorado Avalanche's first year. So if you can dump all these old men for draft picks, maybe this is the year to do it. And maybe it's, there's also a possibility that they're, because of Connor McDavid, the draft depth is being exaggerated by media reports, by people that just have it wrong, and they're going with the trend that this particular draft is deep. Well, we know the 2004 draft was deep. We saw it. We saw it with Crosby and Ovechkin. So maybe this one's just as deep. I don't know. I want to pause. There was a minor one. Tim Gleason goes to the Capitals. They're making moves over there for Jack Hillen for a 2015 fourth-round draft pick. That's between the Carolina Hurricanes and the Washington Capitals. This is a bizarre one. It didn't get too much press. Thomas Fleischman from the he goes to the Panthers making a lot of move. He goes to the Ducks. Congratulations, Fleischman. You had a shot at the Stanley Cup for Danny Heatley in a 2015 third round draft pick. Heatley's been spending time in the minors. There's not really much left of him. I guess what they're doing is they're getting as much veterans for the short term as possible just to make that playoff push, which is great for the Cats. But I mean, you got to think, you're not going to want to give up. If the draft is that deep, you're not going to want to give all these guys up. I mean, that's just nuts.
This is a team that had a possibility of in the beginning of the season was looking at a Connor McDavid.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, and they're going for it.
I don't like the... I mean, they're the Florida Panthers. Let's face it. We're not going to be talking about them in June.
No.
You know? We'll be lucky.
We're not going to be talking about them much past April. I mean, it's...
Yeah, we'll be lucky if we're talking about them past mid-April.
Yeah.
So, but I don't like that they're trying to fill up... I mean, they have a young team.
Mm-hmm.
But they're trying to fill it up with all these old players.
Yeah, I mean, I understand...
I hate to tell you.
I understand players, Winnipeg.
Their
I
bodies
understand.
Break down at the end of the season.
That's true. Especially, I mean, like...
A Danny Heatley? Come on.
Danny Heatley might hurt your locker room too. That's the way. I don't think Yager's going to hurt your locker room so much because they respect
him. No, Yager.
And who knows? Maybe Danny Heatley's feeling, generous, and he wants to give guys rides home, and that's a real fucking problem, as we know. And,
they're sending Danny Heatley down to Miami too.
Yeah. So I mean, we don't know about that. So I found that a little bizarre. I can't believe they would trade a minor leaguer. I thought Danny Heatley was done. I remember that kid called me over the summer. I don't know if you remember this, Matt, because you were on the other side.
Yeah.
You were on a team. And he said, what do you think about Danny Heatley? I said, I don't think it's going to have any impact at all. I don't think there's much left of him. And he just got really quiet. And I said, well, do you disagree with me? And he said, yes. And you could tell he was angry. And we never heard from him again. Well, guess what, kid? I was right again. whatever. The other one, with the other big one.
Here's the problem that Chicago's going to have come next season. The salary cap.
Yeah. Well, because he's on long-term IR, so it doesn't count against the salary cap. I'm talking about Patrick Kane. I'm sure that's going to be a big topic for today.
Them in Boston are in that same – that predicament.
Well, they're going to have to do what Boston did, though. They're going to have to let somebody big go. I mean, they had to let Letty go last year. Boston had to let Boychuk go. That's just the way the system works, spreads the talent around.
Chicago was already predicting this caps thing because before Kane got injured, there was a lot of talk about Sharp leaving. But obviously, since Kane can't play anymore, there's no one that can fill that void. So they're kind of obliged to keep Sharp. But come summertime, it's almost certain that he's going to leave. There's a lot of talk about Sharp going to Washington.
Okay.
Is that...
All right. So, yeah, so, I mean, they'll deal with that. Look, I really don't think it matters with the cap because Chicago's in a different situation than Florida. They're trying to win a Stanley Cup, and they're trying to make moves to increase that without the highest point scorer in the league. And it's no doubt that makes it...
Little in the chat, Little Soyito, He just said something that just puts it all in perspective. Chicago most likely to have to go through the Blues and the Predators, so they have a very tough playoff.
They do. It's tougher than it was without Patrick Kane. I don't think anybody would deny that. I don't think anybody would deny. I do think it's just a ridiculously deep team that does everything well when they're firing on all cylinders, when they're moting and not punching each other in the locker room. Hey, Mr. Newsman, did you ever get a report on what the fist fight was in the Chicago Blackhawks locker room? Any rumor, anything? I'll take it all. Make something up. I don't care.
There's nothing at all.
Okay, make something up.
They're arguing on who their favorite character was on Shotfromthepoint.
Yeah.
Oh, good. No, Jake's better. No, Tommy's
better.
Yeah,
yeah, no. Yeah. I'm the guy that destroyed monetized this.
Yeah.
So my stock has really went down over there in Cronin land.
We only have 9 listeners instead of 10.
Oh, that's good. Yeah, that's why we have 9 listeners instead of 10 today. I've been getting stuff. Fuck you, Tommy. You ruined the show. Fuck you. You owe Cronin a new window. I hope you die. Whatever. Yeah.
I got to listen to this monetized.
Oh, it was really. I will tell the story at the end of it. And that's the thing. If you're listening just to see what I'm going to say, if I'm going to make a statement about monetized this, yes, I am. And I think
as
you're
I
gonna
said
be...
that, we just went down to 7 listeners.
And you're going to hear all more about that. All right, so Anton Vermette, everybody knew he was going. Of course, I don't know what they can do in Arizona. I mean, they're just going to sell people off and hope for the best. Who's the other? Yandel. Yandel's another big name that's been floating around. I think that's probably the best pickup. Vermette's going. Obviously, they're going to keep guys like... Martin Hansel and who's their dopey captain? Didn't like to shake Dustin Brown's hand.
Shane Doan.
And then you have Shane Doan over there. I guess that's the core of the team, but maybe it's time to think a little deeper and break that up, if they'll even be in Arizona. It's just the team's an absolute farce. They should never been put there. You know, Jake's telling he's been to Florida. He can't see anything hockey-related. There's been a team down there for 20 years now. And these guys, I mean, you got to really question the NHL's decision to go say, hey, there's no hockey here. Let's bring it. Well, maybe that's the problem.
I was 2 hours away from Tampa.
Yeah, 2 hours away. No, nobody's talking hockey. I mean, of course, because it's down south. And everybody's into fucking fishing and baseball and drinking beer at all hours of the night.
And also it was the it was like 3 days before the Daytona 500.
I don't know. Why do they try to I put one in Quebec, you know? Hey, would you stop being a Habs fan, Matt, if they got a new team in Quebec? If the Nordiques came back?
No.
Would the Nordiques be closer to you in distance?
I'll never stop being a Habs fan.
I didn't ask you that. Well, yeah, I did. But you won't give the new team a chance? How far is the stadium from you, the one that they just built?
Quebec, like in Quebec City, that'd be about 3 hours.
And how far is Montreal from you? How far is Montreal from you?
An hour.
An hour?
Oh, okay. Oh,
okay. Yeah. All right. You're allowed to be a Habs fan. I give you permission. Don't worry about it.
But I'm open to having a team in Canada.
Yeah, I think it would be better for the rivalry. Yeah. You know, I mean, I think it would just go where the money is. See, I don't think they should make a decision like, let's bring hockey to a new place. They should be like, where is it going to profit and strengthen? If it's not going to be, it might not be Quebec. 20 years ago, they left. So, I mean, Quebec might not be the place.
Even a small market cold, I've even suggested like a Milwaukee, you know, somewhere like that. Like, if they were going to put, the league's fine. There should be no more new teams, but like a Milwaukee or something, somewhere where it's cold. People like hockey. Hell, put another team in New England.
Mm-hmm.
But also from an entertainment point of view, I mean, historically, the rivalry between Montreal and Quebec, it's much more entertaining to watch than Florida, Montreal, where absolutely nothing happens.
Yeah, it's, I don't know. Here's another thing. Here's what I really want to do. No new teams. Stick with what we have. If we have to have 30 teams, please put them in rare markets that we know that will work and not experiments. I'm so sick. Like, we can talk about loss. I'm so sick.
Take them out. Take them out below the Mason-Dixon line.
Look, the bottom line is this, and it's going to cut in their profit and their bottom line, I suppose, but so is producing franchise and franchise that doesn't make a profit, which is what the NHL does best. They make franchises that all the other good teams, like, I don't know, my team, have to pay for. The real solution to the problem, it would give the league incredible strength and probably long-term more popularity, which I don't want. I don't want the game any more popular than it is. It would be knock 10 games off the goddamn season and maybe fold a few teams. initially, I know the Players Association wouldn't like that, but I don't give a damn. I want better hockey out there. I don't care if they have a job or not. And that's really the... And long-term, that would be better because you'd have strong, strong things. And not the original six just carrying it for everybody else. If the original six teams have to carry other franchises, they shouldn't exist. That's why there were six teams for so long. Let's go to Matt's news. We'll go to the Week in Hockey news. I suppose you're going to start on the beginning, Matt. So why don't you... we'll give you a test run here. And if you fuck up, we'll let you know. Matt, the floor is yours.
Okay, well, I already fucked up because it's not in order.
All right, go ahead. I don't care. It's water, really.
Okay, Vermette has been traded to the
Blackhawks.
No
shit, we covered that, you big bean brain.
Did we?
Yeah. You're okay. Let's just pick up.
This is my second time. Give me a chance.
Okay.
Team head over there.
No, keep going. Okay. No, it's good. Oh, let me interrupt you. I got a call from Jersey Jason Lech about I guess my sympathy towards Patrick Kane. Here's how he dealt
somewhere
with
in the top.
Here, listen to this. This is how Jason feels about my compassion towards Patrick Kane's injury. Here you go.
Somewhere in the not so beautiful city of Buffalo, New York, a cabbie is smiling. I know I'm a little late to the dance with that one, but fuck Patrick Kane.
That guy find something to be upset about a 65-degree and sunny day.
I just thought that was funny because I was thinking the same thing. Ah! Oh, Jesus. But go ahead, Matt.
All right. Calgary Flames captain Mark Giordano has been sidelined indefinitely with an undisclosed upper body injury.
Oh, that's horrible.
The NHL's top-scoring defenseman... Mm-hmm. left Wednesday's 3-1 win over the New Jersey Devils in the third period after he was hauled down by Devils forward Steve Bernier.
Oh, those Devils but are so dirty.
But after watching the replay, it's really not the Devils player that hit him. It's an injury that happened on his own. He went to clear the puck, and he went to slap it out, and his stick kind of got caught on the ice, and... I don't know. His shoulder popped out. I can't explain it. You have to watch it.
I know you can't explain it, but yeah. I just, is it okay if I believe that the Devils player, whoever the hell it was, is just
yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. I think it was going with my instinct that they're just a filthy hockey team.
They're barely into fucking hearings for these fucking player hearings. And yeah, think about it. They're never ever mentioned.
I want to believe that, What else you got, Matt?
I also want to believe that Kevin Stevens was, not doing drugs when he was in New York.
Fucking crackhead.
I also want to believe
that crackhead was a Pittsburgh Penguin, as far as I'm concerned.
I also want to believe that Avery was not blowing dudes. So just,
what's wrong with blowing dudes?
There's absolutely nothing with it, but Sean Avery, you know.
I don't think there's anything wrong with blowing dudes.
All right. I got to fucking isolate that clip. I got to learn how to. I just want to keep that for my own. I just want to keep Tommy
the soundboard.
Saying, there's nothing wrong with blowing dudes.
There's nothing wrong with blowing a dude. Absolutely nothing wrong with blowing a dude. Unless you're blowing a.
That's shot from the point stance on gay marriage.
Yeah, nothing wrong with blowing a dude. Yeah. What else you got, Matt?
All right. Logan Couture of the San Jose Sharks was fined $5,000 by the NHL on Friday for tripping Detroit Red Wings defenseman Brendan Smith. It was a slew foot.
Ooh, slew. Wasn't Roy that told us, that never happens? Who was the last guy to get fined for a slew foot? Well, there you go, Roy. There's another fucking guy.
Yeah.
What else
Smith, Smith actually hit his head on the ice. He had to leave, though.
But, oh, well.
Yeah.
Look out. Well, what do you got? 5,000? You didn't get any games?
No.
Oh, well. What else you got?
Okay. Defenseman Brett Sopel, who spent 12 seasons playing in the NHL and won the Stanley Cup in 2010 with the Chicago Blackhawks, announced his retirement on Friday.
Oh. That's right, because I guess he's been floating around the minor leagues. Didn't he? Speaking of blowing people, wasn't he big on gay marriage and stuff like that? Wasn't he an LBG LGBT FYU FUCKYLU
LGBT BLT
LGBT I'll have a fries and coke with that. I don't know. Like, was he involved in that, or am I just off base here?
I wouldn't know.
I don't know. Yes, for the sake of the argument.
All right, what else you got?
Okay, as if the Kings aren't thin enough on defense, they place Alec Martinez on injury reserve.
Jesus.
Oh, Christ. Alec Martinez, he's my favorite King of all time.
Yeah.
You know why?
Wait a minute. Alec Martinez. Wasn't he running around freaking New England killing people? Shouldn't he be in jail? I don't know.
No, that's Alex.
Oh, Martinez. Yeah. That's right.
Alec Martinez. He scored the game-winning goal in the Stanley Cup last year.
Yeah. You know what happened when that goal happened? I called my girlfriend and I said...
all morning.
Yeah. Right?
All morning.
Yeah, I'll say.
Okay, for all of those people who thinks that I'm pubescent and that was a voice crack, that was not a voice crack. I was choking on my own tears.
Crying
and I'm not ashamed
morning.
Of saying that.
You're not saying ashamed of crying. And let's remind
crying
everybody what you were crying all morning and warning about. What were you crying all morning about? Tell the story. Big killer deal that the Habs made that just kind of like was a blip for about 8 minutes on Hot Puck Daddy and all the other sites. Who said
Puck Daddy? Let me explain it to you.
Okay, let me hear this.
CCAC was a free agent.
Yeah.
CCAC was a free agent. 15 teams wanted him.
Uh-huh.
Out of all of the 15 teams, he came to Montreal. Yeah. And we decided to play him on our fourth line, not even on his natural position.
Because he kept turning over the fucking puck, I found out.
Well, he's a rookie. He never played in North America.
Yeah.
I mean, cut him a bit of slack.
That's what Igor Lariano's saying, that they got to let these guys create, otherwise they'll never be good. I think there's some truth in it. Yeah, here's the problem. The stupid, simple game wins more often than it doesn't. And I think the only guys that can play the beautiful game, like I just don't want to turn fucking hockey into soccer, are really, you have to have like the highest end of the highest end athletes. Like, well, it worked for Russia. Well, yeah, it worked for Russia because they're like, there was like, Fetisov, Konstantinov, Krutov, and Larionov were like the four best, you could say they're the best four players of all time. That's why it worked. But that's what Lariano said, like guys like CCAC. And that happened, I think, after the Lariano letter.
Matt, were you, like, legitimately, were you, like, crying like bawling?
All morning.
Were you?
Legitimately, no. I was really angry.
Yeah.
And my sister was driving me to school. And to manifest my anger, I kind of shoved her. And we almost went into a car accident.
How dare you?
That's completely unrelated.
How very arrogant of you, beating women?
Yeah, what's the matter with you? I met his sister a few days ago. How dare you?
I was angry. I'm sorry. I didn't mean
you,
to
what
do
you didn't mean to fucking get you in a car accident? You can tell that to the fucking Undertaker, you chickhead. Fuckhead.
Matt Chrysaur.
Matt Chrysaur.
Hey, I love my hockey. I'm not afraid of saying that. I love it.
Yeah,
I'm passionate about it.
I you know what? That's always an excuse for being an asshole in my experience. But go be passionate.
I'm shaking
all morning.
What was your reaction when the Rangers didn't win last year?
I went on and said I congratulated the fucking Kings. You can watch the goddamn video.
You weren't a little bit sad?
No, because I think I would have been a little more devastated. I was actually a little more devastated the year before because I don't think we were much worse than the Devils. This one, I was like watching the Kings. Like it's like game one. That's a better hockey team. You know, I mean, like we lose to these guys. I didn't think it was a big deal, and it was just a fluke that we went as deep as we did. So, I wasn't that devastated. Absolutely not. I'm not one of these guys. I'm weird. I'm not one of these guys. What you gotta do is you gotta believe. No, it's not true at all. You can believe whatever the fuck you like. The Rangers are gonna win the cup or the not. You know? I don't know. Like, people ask me, like,
Tommy doesn't care because Tommy still has 94.
I think that when I have 94 and you don't. It was better than any Stanley Cup.
I have 95.
Can you name a better Stanley? What was a better Stanley Cup since? None. Zero. Zip. The fucking Stanley Cup the year before that, Montreal won, and it was over a fucking stick curvature. Those Frenchies are trying any way to fucking win. They caught Marty McSorley with a fucking half of a stick curve, and the Kings fell apart. Gretzky should have had that cup. Fucking Kings were hot that year, and they collapsed over McSorley's stick. Still not over.
I didn't
over
see
it.
That, but I'm sure there's other reasons than a stick.
No, they collapsed. You got it. It's generally considered they mentally collapsed.
Frenchie Ben just said ice is meeting in a car. That's right. I just picture Matt when he pushed his sister. Yeah. He's probably in the back of a pickup truck with a fucking Uzi in the back.
Jesus Christ.
Okay, no. But I didn't make it clear. I didn't push her. I accidentally shoved her. I got overexcited and I waved my arm and accidentally shoved her. That's it.
What are you, nuts? What are you, fucking crazy?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You're the type that's gonna fucking push over a car if Montreal ever wins the cup.
Yeah, I know. That's the problem. It's people like you. Jesus Christmas. All right, we're only half, and I got to keep a timer.
In your fucking Clark Kent glasses. I shouldn't really be talking.
All right, what else
Super
you got?
ISIS.
I was going for the Jake Link look.
Thank you.
Yeah, he didn't know he's wearing glasses. Now everybody's wearing glasses because they're getting fucking old, and you're wearing glasses because you're a goddamn hipster. I don't even know why you're on. But go ahead.
No, because I wouldn't be able to read the news if not. So,
anyway. Really? You're that fucking blind?
Whoa, these are like your reading glasses? Like an old man?
I'm going on. Wait, how much you want to bet when Jake's
blind? You're gonna make fun of my eye problems now?
Yeah, probably. Make fun of the fact that you're a fucking Arab. Make fun of your Arab.
Of your ISIS problems.
Make fun of that. You know, everybody's nervous when they have to fly next to you, even though you're Catholic. It's funny, you know? Why not?
Oh, it's funny. It's funny that you bring it up because you probably don't know this, but I'm in the U.S. right now. I'm in New Hampshire.
Oh, lucky you. Yeah.
And I don't know if it's because I'm trying to grow a beard right now, but we got stopped at the customs.
Yeah, good timing. Good timing. Yeah. Hey, you know what? We'll go over the thing and make sure. Well, I'll grow a beard right before I out, even though I'm of military age, and I'll scare the fuck out of the border patrol. Yeah, good move, Matt. You know,
dude, I don't have anything to hide. They just
you
should have
dyed your hair
oranges.
Blonde and acted like you were like a hip hop guy. That would have fucking gone over better than what you did. All right, Liz, what's up? What else is in the news?
That's one of them that's trying to get us. Is a hip hop guy.
Well, yeah, maybe. Go. Well, what's in the news? Let's keep this train moving. 718-395-7660 or Skype is shot from the point. Go.
Okay. Buffalo Sabres goaltender Michael Neuwirth has been fined $2,000 as supplementary discipline under the NHL Rule 64 over diving embellishment.
Good. Fucking jerk. I don't even know if he did it or not. I don't care. I just want people fined for diving. I don't care if it's right or not.
You know
I don't
what
care.
It sounds like this week. It sounds like none of us watched a game.
Not me. I watched tons of games, but I didn't watch. You know what it is? I went out with my wife to see American Sniper, and I didn't watch Friday and Saturday. I had to catch up and do the news reports. But I watched 20 games this week. It's conservatively 20 games this week.
But it just sounds like good. We're just saying whatever.
Good. No, good. I just want people
what,
fine
what
for
time. What was the fight about in the locker room?
Well, that's the idea. He brings the news to us. We comment on it. I don't got to know what he's saying. That's the point. Yeah. You're doing your job. What else is in the news? Good. Fuck that guy. You know, whoever he was.
Okay, the Los Angeles Kings have signed forward Kyle Clifford to a 5-year contract extension.
Super move. What else you got in the news?
Okay, well,
that doesn't mean that I'm mad that you brought up the story. It just means I don't want to talk about it. That has nothing to do. So don't be fucking self-conscious and shit.
Okay, you probably won't want to hear that they also signed Jordan Nolan to a 3-year extension.
Woo-hoo! What a move! Go next. Next.
Let's concentrate on that for a few hours.
Yeah, let's talk about that. Mm.
Tommy, that should have been the topic of today's show. You should have just...
Yeah, I know. Why didn't I headline that? I'd have fucking like 5 more fucking viewers in here right now. What the fuck am I thinking? Jesus Christ. Go ahead. What else?
Okay. This one's a bigger contract, though. Nick Leddy signed a 7-year extension worth $38.5 million.
Boy, has that worked out or what for them? I mean, that has just been the best thing for them. Nick Leddy over there in the island. And the Boychuk thing. I mean, it changed their season. It changed their season. Let's take a call out of friggin' Texas. Deb from Texas, what's on your mind?
Hey, Tommy, how you doing?
How you doing? What's going on? What's going on?
I'm doing.
I'm in a lot of trouble, actually.
What?
I'm in a lot of trouble.
Why?
The Joe Cronin fans hate me. I don't think okay. Then you know what it is? I'm testing to see if you're one of my fans or Cronin fans, so you know exactly what I was talking about. But good, that means I got you. But go ahead. What was your call for there?
Well, I kind of wanted to talk about the Hawks.
So go ahead. Talk about whatever you want. Talk about fucking Maddie's anger problem with his fucking sister. What do you think about that, him pushing a woman around like that? I don't care if it's
I told you I didn't push her. It was an accident.
What do you think about that? Jesus,
we gotta call. Rocks at
we gotta call. You know what we're gonna do? We're gonna call Anita Sarkeesian, the Pink Punk, and Greg Wyshynski, and chase you down, buddy. And we're gonna get you. Well, what's on your mind, Deb?
That's right. Matt Christopher Matt Brown Kazar.
Let her talk. You dope. What'd you say, sweetie?
Well, I don't care if Matt pushes his sister. She just needs to push back.
Oh, see, that's why we like Deb. That's why she's one of ours. What's going on with the Hawks?
Find their siblings, so I don't care.
No. She can accidentally shove me back, because that's what happened. It was an accident.
I hope she punches you straight in the jaw and knocks those glasses off your face. How about that?
Hey, Matt, is your favorite player? Matt, is your favorite player in the NHL, Sergei Voronov?
Yeah, he's like, yeah, he comes up with his Voronov jersey and lays down the law. Deb, let Debbie talk. What do you got, Deb? Talk about the Hawks.
Well, I'm trying to talk.
I know. This is the worst call to call, show to call if you want to get a word in edgewise. But go ahead.
Well, I was going to ask
Jake. I got to tell you something, Jake. Yeah, go ahead, Deb. Go ahead.
I might never call again, Tony.
Oh, you wouldn't do that to me, would you? Would you?
I don't know.
Shut up! What you talking to me? Sorry. You wouldn't do that to me, would you?
Well, I was going to say is I'm more excited about Vermette than Kima is right now.
Oh, sure, yeah. You know,
but if Kima can play, I'm fine with it.
Hey, look, if he's okay and he says he's okay, the problem is I don't trust 39-year-old athletes. They think they're 22. So I'd love to. Kimmo Tiiminen is definitely being an addition to the Blackhawks if all things were equal. Would you agree with that, Deb?
Yes.
Yeah, so it's great. It's just I don't trust 39-year-old athletes that are the career's closing. They're just going to – so I know what these guys are like. They're like, I can do this, and they can't because you have to have that super positive attitude, and it's impossible to trust their judgment. Also, I'm a little worried about him. But if he comes in there and plays like Kimmo Tiiminen and Ken, you guys have just gotten better, and you've more than replaced Johnny Oduya. And when Oduya comes back, you can put him on the same pairing. If you wanted to, or mix them up, it would be great. I just don't, you know, I don't know what that does. What Anton Vermette brings you is he's a playmaking forward that actually can cover his own zone, and he also can actually, you know, feed guys, and you have plenty of depth out there. So I honestly believe that you know, none of these. I don't think the only problem I would have is sending the the second round draft pick for Tiiminen. I don't get that. That part I don't get. But otherwise, I don't think it's a bad move. That's it. What else do you think about it?
Well, we'll see, because their next game is tomorrow. And both of them are playing, so we'll see.
Yeah, we'll see. So, I mean, I don't think it hurts your chances this year, and that's what's most important. I mean, let's face it, Chicago's a win-now team. Would you agree with that? So they're making moves to increase those odds, and that's all general managers can do at the end of the day, and hope they don't trade Sagan, you know, like, or C-Cash, according to Matt.
I got another point before I go.
Go ahead.
All this talk about off-ice bitches is pissing me off.
Who? What bitches? Tell me the story.
Like, all these, like, this guy on Twitter just tweeted out some crap about the locker room being off or something, and
all for men?
Fights and all that crap, and I'm like, really?
Look, I don't understand. I want to come to your defense, but all for, like, only male reporters? Is that what they're saying, or?
Yeah, they're all men.
Well, no, I wouldn't worry about that too much, because
I'm not worried about it either, because it's just
a dopey thing to say. The only thing that I'd say on it, first of all, ignore ignorant morons, okay? What I would say. What I will say is I don't think it's right, depending on these guys' personal belief, if they're, like, it's not, like, I gotta be honest with you, I have no religious beliefs or anything like that, or I don't think I'm hung up in sexuality, but, like, let's say I was an athlete and you were standing, and I'm washing my dick, and you're standing there asking me questions, I got a problem with that. Because my dick's small and I don't want you to see it. You know what I mean?
Irish curse.
And, but so, yeah, it's gonna be Irish curse going on. What are you going to do? My poor wife. Think about her. Yeah. But no, I that part I get. As far as being in the locker room, no, I don't have a problem with, but I do have a problem with them getting changed. And I understand that because I would be personally uncomfortable. Do women belong in the locker room? Yes. And here's the way to solve it. Nobody's getting it. Nobody's allowed in when you're changing. Everybody's got to be unnaked. And I know they don't. Nobody wants to do that because the male reporters will have a fit over that. But I got to be honest with you. I respect these guys' privacy, and I don't know if I'd want a dude doing it. I don't even. It's anything to do with women. But don't listen to those guys. They're dopes. But I
well,
do.
Well, Tommy, do you know what the rumor is?
What's that?
It's like they're saying Patrick Sharp slept with Duncan Keith's wife.
Oh, ooh. That's a problem.
Yeah, and the player just came out today just saying about how it's totally not true and it's messing up the chemistry.
Oh, I bet. I bet. That. And I tell you something. If that's true, because we had the same situation with Rod Bindermore and Eric Lindros in the East Coast a few years back. It destroyed their cup chances.
The Phantom Black
If that Hawk. Happened, and that's just a rumor, I got to be honest with you, Deb, that Chicago Blackhawks team is in fucking trouble. That changes everything that I said about Vermette or Kiemannin or the fact that they can recover from Patrick Kane's loss, even though it's going to be difficult. That changes everything. And I know that from a psychological standpoint. I know a standpoint. I've been in an Army unit where that happened, and it destroyed everything slowly. It even destroyed things that were unrelated to it and infected other people because you couldn't have the two guys in the room or you couldn't have this and you had to do that. If that is true.
Yeah, that's why all the talks about Patrick Sharp was just so on Twitter these couple of days, like, oh my gosh, are they going to move him for this or that or whatever?
Oh,
and then
big.
Patrick Sharp's agent just said, no, they're not going to trade him. I'm like, I don't know what's weird anymore.
If one of those guys goes, then you know. In fact, I tell you something, no matter who did what, whether the guy that was the victim of it or the guy that slept with the guy's wife, one of those guys have to go. So if you see a bizarre trade before the deadline tomorrow, that's now you know. If that's true, and we don't know, it's totally rumor. But Deb, that's huge. And I tell you something, that's why the guys don't want guys in the because there's always some guy that can't keep his dick in his pants that's willing to fuck your wife. There is. There's always a guy out there like that. That's why they want the women. Now I see what you're getting at. I thought you were talking about reporters being in there. I got to be honest with you, Deb. I don't, in the Army, we separated locker rooms. I just don't know why. There's a reason. There's social reasons we do that. And I don't think they're all wrong. I don't think all traditions should be upheld. But, you know, maybe getting changed and women not being in the room is one of them. I don't know. Just me. Maybe I'm wrong. I want everybody to get a fair shot. I want women to get a fair shot. But I tell you something, I'd be awful uncomfortable if women could be in the locker room with naked. Like, I wouldn't want my wife around naked guys in the locker room that are, like, all in good shape. Nah, man, I'm sorry. And I don't think that's me being, like, a prude or anything. I think it's just normal.
No, I get what you're saying.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying? That's what I'm saying. Like, and I know what you're worried about, which is legitimate. Well, all the female reporters will get the fucking shaft if all the guys can be in there and they can't. I think that's what you're saying. And you want women involved in sports and have a fair shake like everybody else, which is totally legitimate. But I got to be honest with you. Maybe some of our institutions, and some of them are okay to keep. I don't know. Maybe I'm not for unisex bathrooms, if you know what I mean. And I'm totally for gay marriage. You know, it's like it's the whole world's getting weird. But I'm not getting on politic rant. But thanks for calling, Deb. Really good call.
Yep, thank you.
You're the best. And I interrupted you for fun. I didn't mean to hurt your feelings.
You didn't hurt my feelings, Tommy. I'm not bad.
I don't want to lose you. You're my only female caller. In fact, call me after the show, please.
Run for your life.
I know. That's why I threatened you.
Call me after the show, please. All right. I'll talk to you later, Deb. Have a good one. Jesus. If she doesn't call me back, you know what I'm going to do?
All morning.
You got it.
And then you're going to hit her?
I don't know. Am I off on that? What else you got in the news, Dopey?
Right. Cam Ward has played his 500th NHL game on Thursday.
Good for him.
Cam Ward's like probably like the most, he's really a superstar for like 3 minutes, and then that was all.
Yeah. Well, he won a cup with them, right?
He did.
Yeah, he did win a cup with them. He's been on the team a long time.
He's one of those cases of a player who, like, peaked way too early in his career.
I got to be honest with you. I hate milestones, especially game milestones. I played fine. I don't give a fuck, you know.
Dylan, yeah. Showed up every day.
Yeah, sure, great. I mean, we made it 500 times. I mean, it is an accomplishment. Don't get me wrong. I just don't want to hear about it. I mean, I want to hear, like, who broke. I want to hear who broke the goal record, the assist record, the points record, and all that other shit you can have. You know, that's about it.
I don't like, you know, like the Cal Ripken record is like, dude, he showed up.
And, all right, that was like one of a kind. Like, I want the top records. I don't like he's 17th away from most goals of all time. Fucking care. Tell me when he's two. You know.
Well, that's
tell
the
me
thing.
When he's number two. You know,
Gretzky's made it damn near impossible that we
appreciate
number two. You know.
Yeah. He wasn't even the best player of all time, Bobby Orr was, but I'm kind of glad because it just aggravates hipsters that everybody likes Gretzky. But go ahead. Speaking of hipsters, Matt.
Right. Dustin Penner has been pulled from the TSN trade deadline coverage after making a rape joke on Twitter.
Rape jokes? Rape jokes are hysterical. What are you talking about?
Yeah, nobody gets hurt.
Oh, my God. Well, at least he made a rape joke and didn't rape anybody. Boy, they're really uptight there on TSN.
What was the joke? I want to know what the joke was.
Tell me the joke.
The joke was, hold on. I have it right here.
Yeah, you did.
I didn't get it, though, but...
Do I have to do this for you, rape joke? It's the top on Puck Daddy. It's the easiest one to do.
Yeah, wait. My computer's
slow. You're worse than fucking Jeff.
Shit.
I can't win. I can't win, Jake. No matter
what are you like a Hampton Inn or something right now?
Fucking one, like one dopey guy after another. I mean, what can I?
How the hell did you know?
I can tell. I can tell. I can tell from all the artwork on the wall.
He is like the Hampton Inn. He really is. You know what you should be trying to do as soon as you get over there? You should be trying to get laid. Is over there. That's, you know, hotels in my experience were great time for premarital sex. You know,
always.
You know, just
I'm
lie
I'm
about
sharing
here's
a
what you
room
do.
With my dad.
You lie. Well, then no, don't give up. Maybe she's got lie about your age, lie about your future, do all the all the normal things. You know, the guys do to get laid.
Tommy, that
and
doesn't
cocaine.
Change the fact that
cocaine helps the most. You know,
tell him that like
yeah,
listen, you're taking care of your...
too, I guess.
Tell your dad to take a walk.
You know? Put a tie on the door.
Yeah, you know? just tell him. Don't worry, she's a Muslim. You know, actually, she'd probably throw her out the window if you knew that. But look, what you got the rape joke yet? Even though we spotted
yeah,
you,
yeah,
time? Yeah. Here we go. Go ahead, tell me the rape joke.
Is it always consensual if she's your girlfriend asking for my girlfriend and shortly arriving police?
That's not even that funny.
Yeah,
what else did he write? Here's the thing. Dustin Penner has admitted to wanting to be a comedian, right? And, you know.
Good luck.
That's how I feel. Every time I go to Dustin Penner's website, I feel that way, you know? But here's the thing. He signed on with, he's a really good defenseman. I'm surprised he can't find a spot in the lineup. And he played last year for the Ducks. Yeah, he played for the Kings 2 years ago. I'm surprised he quit. You can't be a comedian and a TSN personality. He found that out the hard way. You can't be funny. You can't be funny. That's why I got my own stupid fucking YouTube channel. Because you can't be irreverent and a mainstream sports guy. And I guess he wants to be both. I mean, let's just face it. It's a matter of time before Jeremy Roenick gets canned. You know? You can't be irreverent. You can't be a human being. You got to be a fucking robot. You can't be both. You can't be for PJ
like,
Stock.
You realize, like, if this show, like, got picked up by a network.
Yeah.
Or, like this, it would be the shortest run hockey show in the history of just. Because they'd be like, you can't say this. You can't say that.
It's
you can't
work.
Talk about them.
Yeah, so, I don't know why he didn't know that. I mean, it's like, I don't have a problem with his joke. I don't even think, it's not super funny. It's far from offensive. And the only people that get offended are people that it's not about being offended so much. They just want to tell you how to think. Ooh, you said a rape joke. Well, it's a joke. Nobody got hurt. It's a joke. That's it. It wasn't hateful. And I mean, I read in the Tuck Daddy's like, well, you know how many victims there are each year? Well, what the fuck's that got to do with anything? Of course, there's a lot of murder victims. I can't make a murder joke. You know, I mean, people make jokes. Like, it's ridiculous. We've gone on over this in nauseam. You know, your rights don't end because they hurt other. What you want to say, your speech rights. I got tied up. Your speech rights don't end if they hurt somebody's feelings. And that seems to be it. But, I mean, look, TSN's a private organization. They don't want guys telling rape jokes. Dustin Penner should have known about that. I mean, I can't believe he didn't. You know, in the environment. You ever read Puck Daddy? These guys are looking to call you guys out in every turn. They're looking to throw each other on the bus. Harrison Mooney, Datter, all these guys. So what makes you think you're better than that? What, because you're like a liberal guy? You're like the liberal kooky Twitter guy? Well, you think you could have been the kooky Twitter guy on TSN? What are you, fucking nuts? Are you ignorant? But at the same time, I sympathize with Penner because I like when people are allowed to talk like they want to talk without punishment. I think the line is this. If it's something really, really hateful, like I think all blank should be dead. That's never funny. You know? It's never funny. It's never funny. I wish they would die. He's telling a joke about if anybody should be offended, it should be his girlfriend. But then we have a bunch of self-righteous lefties that are like religious church ladies and tell people what to do. So,
you know, it's just certain words. It's just certain words that you say nowadays that just offend people.
I think
I said a joke. It was an open mic at a TGI Fridays, and I said a joke. I said a line about arguing with my wife. If you want to get her to stop arguing with her, just call her a faggot.
Exactly. Because what you're doing is the irony of the fact that she couldn't be a faggot because she's a female. But see, here's the thing.
But people got upset because I just said faggot.
Yeah, yeah.
That's all.
That's it. You know, to be offended. You crossed the line. You broke the new rule. You know, not even thinking for maybe the new rule's stupid. Or maybe people aren't really offended. They're just looking to seem important. You can never feel more important when you're righteously offended. And I'm sick of these self-righteous jerk-offs. I grew up, you know, my grandmother was a certain type of Christian that I won't say because I don't want to throw them under the bus. But my view of them is they were fucking kooks. And one of the things that drove me nuts, they were moralists, pointing everything out that you're doing wrong. No, she wasn't Catholic. That was my other side of the family. And it was just like a holier-than-thou thing. And that's what this this stupid word we have called offense or being offended. It's just a stupid word to begin with. And people are just actively searching it out, not to end racism, not to help rape victims, it's just so they can stand over another. And I don't understand why Dustin Penner didn't understand that. He doesn't read Puck Daddy? He didn't know what happened to Harrison Mooney? You know, he doesn't know that the female hockey bloggers have had sports reporters lost their jobs over, like, hey, send me a cute picture of yourself. And you make a rape joke? Hey, Dustin Penner, I just want to let you know that we're taking applications here at Shot from the Point. You'd fit right fucking in! But I don't think you want to work for free. So, lighten up, sell out, and become one of them. Or start your own YouTube channel. I'm shocked you didn't know this. I thought you were smarter than this. I know you see yourself as this sort of irreverent hockey guy that's a little, you know, he's kind of hip and he's cool. Well, guess what? Well, welcome to the media, the ultimate church ladies. Next story. What are you laughing at? Don't laugh at me.
I'm laughing at Jake's comment.
What did Jake write? Americans are always offended. Ridiculous. It's true.
He wrote.
You're right.
No, not that. He said, I tweeted to Kim Kardashian that she's been... Wait, should I say this?
No. I think I know what it is and don't say it.
Okay.
No. That's
no, because Frenchie Ben was talking about that it's a Twitter joke, not a living room joke. And I said I don't know the difference.
Yeah.
And he said, there's a medium. I said, I'm the guy that tweeted to Kim Kardashian.
Yeah.
Said joke.
No, I'm not. Not yet.
You know what? It's not an offensive joke.
You know what? I want to be premier to principle. Tell the fucking joke, Jake.
I tweeted to Kim Kardashian that she's been passed around by so many black guys that she should have Spalding written on her ass.
Oh, Jesus. All right. Let's take that joke apart, everybody. That's a racist joke. That is certainly a racist joke. Is it a hateful joke? Well, no. No. Nobody's dying. They're making association between African Americans and basketball, which is undeniable. There's more Africans than Americans. Is it offensive? Could it piss off some people? Yeah, sure. Yeah, sure. But we don't fucking. It's a nightclub joke. And Jake can tell it because he's an amateur comedian.
I have immunity. Yes.
Yeah, he does have a little bit of immunity, but I just like, and I don't. I want to be around you. I want people to. If I thought Jake was racist for a minute, I wouldn't have been doing him. But if he told an edgy racist joke, I don't care. I wouldn't can him for that. I'd only get rid of somebody if they said something hateful.
He's the one that gave me all my nicknames.
Yeah, God, I mean, Jesus Christ, we pick on him more than anyone.
I love Matt.
I mean, look, I don't get picked on because I'm kind of captain of this team as much. But I mean, if you see me on Cronin Show, I get thrown under the bus all the time.
Let me tell you, Tommy. Let me tell you.
What? Yeah. Look, they're
wrong.
Goofing on
you're
me.
Wrong. No, you're wrong.
I'm crazy. I'm stupid. I interrupt people all the time. You know, like you're sure, but it's just a goof. It's a goof. That's all. And honestly, it's like, well, you know, that hurts. That offends people. Fucking who cares? Is there a line? Yeah. But we can't, the line is now, nobody gets their feelings hurt. We can't live in a society and have free speech and everybody get their feelings, not get their feelings hurt.
It never offended me once.
I know, because you're Catholic and you hate Muslims, that's why. Next story. I had enough of this. You know?
Okay, so the Blue Jackets, who haven't been fortunate at all with injuries, have finally activated goalie Bobrovsky.
Bobrovsky! Good for him.
Bobrovsky!
Bobrovsky. Anything funny happened this week? I thought something funny. Didn't Ovechkin tell somebody to grow hair or something? Or was that last week?
That was like
that was
2 weeks
last week.
All right. What else you got? I was hoping for that. Patrick Kane get hurt this week?
So, I don't know. Apparently there's some passing around of wives in the Chicago Blackhawks locker room.
I just got to riff for a second. Debbie in Texas, who is half African-American, half Caucasian, she said, it's funny because it's true.
That's right. You see, I have gotten approval.
Because Debbie knows this isn't an indictment on all black women.
Half approval.
It's just an outrageous joke to be. it's an outrageous joke to be deliberately over the top. Who cares? Half approval. I got half. Oh, that's awful. I just figured that out. I just figured that one out.
I dated a few half black. Half
my
black
first
girls.
Kiss was from an African American woman. You know that?
A African American.
An African American woman. I say that.
Did
now.
You say? Did you say?
I kissed a black girl. That was the first kiss I ever got. It was cool.
And I liked it.
Yeah, kind of did. I was. I wish I was smarter. I wish I could have closed that deal, but I was 13. She was actually. You know what the bizarre thing is? Oh, I can't say that. I'm married. I'm not saying she was the most attractive woman I've ever, even though it was only 13 because she's like a year and a half older than me. So she had been like, she was like through puberty. One of these 14-year-old girls that looked like she's like 25, you know, but she was 14 and I was 13. I got to be honest with you, with the exception of my wife, she may have been the most beautiful woman I ever kissed in my life.
Did she lose a bet?
No, she was interested in me. She told me how
was
cute I was.
Was she mad at her dad?
I don't know. I thought that might have been going on. I'm gonna kiss away. They were rich, so like
it's funny. My cousin, his name's Marlon.
Yeah,
and he was dating this black girl named Jessica. Yeah. And I was like, wow, you don't really know a lot of black girls named Jessica. And he said, yeah. How many white guys do you know named Marlon?
Make a point.
Could you imagine like both of their families like for dinner? It's like, yeah, no, I'm bringing my girlfriend Jessica over. Oh, can't wait to meet her. What? Oh, I'm bringing my boyfriend Marlon over. Can't wait to meet him.
Yeah.
This is Marlon. What?
I don't know. That fucking, what was that movie that, it was this dumb movie. It actually took place in Cranford, New Jersey. The one that,
That's where my cousin's from.
Cranford? My family. My father went to Cranford High. Yeah. What's that? What was that movie they made with who's the guy who played Steve Jobs recently in that dumb, that horrible Apple movie about Steve Jobs? What was his name? He's a terrible actor.
I don't know what you're talking about. Fucking
Ashton Kutcher. Yeah.
Ashton Kutcher. Yeah.
Yeah. Ashton Kutcher. He did a movie. about dating a black girl and reading his rich. That was
guess who's coming to dinner?
Yeah, yeah. That was done in Cranford, New Jersey, if you remember. They showed the train station and everything.
Tommy, there might be a trade with the Rangers.
What's coming in? Is it coming in? What do you got? We're taking.
Wait, Jeff sent it in the chat, but I just want to confirm
Jeff's doing his fucking job, unlike you.
Well, this is Jeff's job.
He's not here.
I'm just taking his place.
Yeah, you're doing fine, actually. But
I'm not as sharp. I'm not as
Jeff's
smart.
Not that sharp either.
No, you're doing fine.
You're doing fucking great, actually.
I'm not even as bummed.
Fucking playing a video game or watching a football game, you jerk.
Yeah, you're not yelling about the fucking Rams. Yeah. Goddamn Steve Spagnuolo.
Yeah. Fucking
Jeff
trying.
Fisher, why would you do a zone defense right there?
Yeah, never do that.
And like he catches me off guard.
Yeah.
It was like, I normally have the game on, but like a different game. Yeah. And he's just like I actually like cringe a little bit. I'm like, whoa, is there something I'm supposed to be missing?
Hey, what was it? All right, go on with the other story. Let's keep this rolling. I don't even know how much time we've done so far.
Okay. Earlier this day, there was two smaller not even trades, there were pickups. The Leafs picked up Tim Erickson from the Hawks.
Yeah.
And the Flames claimed Schlemko from the Stars.
Schlemko. Well, I'm sure that's a game changer, too. What else you got?
Schlemko.
Schlemko.
Sounds like a fake company.
Yeah, I know. Hey, will you go to Schlemko and pick me two 5x4s up? And, you know, because I want to put them in my shed. Schlemko. Yeah.
Schlemko, we have everything.
Schlemko. Welcome to Schlemko. Don't put us on waivers. I don't know. Fucking start. The jokes aren't working. Go to the next story, Matt.
Yeah, hold on. Because.
No, you're doing this on fucking tabs, too, which is I've been telling fucking Jeff not to do forever.
Okay, yeah. I have it.
You're doing this on tabs. I know it. I might make
trade.
A rule. No fucking tabs. I'm thinking about
that. I have the trade.
Oh, the trade's in. All right, that's actually you doing your job. What's the trade, bud?
It's on sportsnet.ca.
Oh, yeah, those been going to the Rangers! Keith Yandel! Is that right?
Yep.
Yeah! Big for who? Wait a minute. Hold on.
And you heard it here.
You're maybe going to be sad about this, but they acquired Dan Girardi.
No shit.
Ooh.
Yeah, because he's kind of an old-timer. They've lost faith in him, and last year he wasn't really a factor like they'd hoped. He was the leader of that defense for a long time, and I'm not terribly comfortable at breaking that up, but he has not been, he's been good recently, as consistent a D-man, and we saw it in the playoffs a little bit. Actually, Anton Strawman was the more consistent D-guy. Oh, I bet that shocked the shit out of him. Would you have thought that, Jake, that they got rid of Girardi? I mean, he was a cornerstone of that team for years.
No, that's – you know what? I don't know how I feel. I know Yadel is a top-notch defenseman, but sometimes when
he's also – but he has offense. He's an offensive defenseman, so we got rid of a defensive defenseman for an offensive defenseman. I don't think it's a bad move.
I don't know how that's going to work.
I didn't know he was on the block.
I didn't know either. I always thought Dan Girardi, you know, just
– Rangers playing tonight?
Being a staple of that team. I don't think they're playing tonight, no.
Wow. Girardi for Yandel. So if Girardi's on, then are they definitely playing a prospect for taking?
I think this is going to hurt the Rangers.
Glenn Slater. This is Ryan Lampert. Glenn Slater is really terrible at giving out contracts, but really good at getting rid of them. That's funny. Ryan Lampert. Yeah, I mean, they lost. They kind of lost. He was the cornerstone of that defense, and McDonough took over. I would say at the end of the 2013 season, and then he wasn't the impact player defender during the Stanley Cup playoffs, and I think they kind of lost faith with him, and they want to bring Andel in, who probably can give them a more of an offensive threat. McDonough's not an offensive threat. In fact, what was their last thing, Delzato, that was their last big offensive defenseman. I'm actually, the more I think about it, the more I like it.
Yeah.
Hey, and, what time does the DM trade the trade deadline? What time does the trade deadline happen? When is that over? Do you know?
No,
is
I don't
it
know.
Today?
No, because I got to.
It's tomorrow for... at. I
probably
I think
3 o'clock.
I need to know. I've been searching all over this place. I need to know this.
Probably 3 o'clock tomorrow.
3 o'clock tomorrow. 3 o'clock, so I can go on at 9 o'clock.
Yeah.
Yeah, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to do Shot from the Point Radio. I'm thinking about doing like a mega long broadcast. So once we get them in, we're going to talk about them. And you guys can call in, stay on, do what you want. And I'm going to be playing commercial music and all what have you. So we'll debut Shot from the Point Radio tomorrow. And
that's right.
And then, of course,
and we're going to be here taking your phone calls, taking donations.
I'll take, apparently the Jets scored to Terry. Actually, what are the scores going on in the NHL? All right, what else story you got? We haven't even gotten to Patrick Kane yet, for Christ's sakes.
Okay, I'll do Patrick Kane. Mm. He will be out 12 weeks after a shove by Panthers defenseman Petrovic. That caused him to lose balance and crash right into the boards.
I don't know if he wouldn't have fell either way. I mean, he hit him so lightly.
Yeah, and to give you a time estimate, he will not return until the possible Western Conference final.
No, that means it's probably late in the second round, if anything. But, yeah.
Yes.
Well, we could go on and on at nauseam, but people are going on and on at nauseam all week, like what this does. I mean, it's bad for the league. It's bad for the Hawks. It's bad for another reason. It's bad that apparently they're sticking each other's dicks and fucking their wives over there. There's a lot of things wrong with this.
Like the Yankees.
I mean, like, you know, I saw what's his name, Coach Quinville, and he was just like, well, you know, it's always tough to lose the highest scoring player in the team. And I'm thinking, well, yeah, no shit. Since when? Yeah, it's huge. It's huge. But, I mean, if any team can sort of swallow it, they can. I'm more concerned about, I'm actually sort of more concerned with, I'm more concerned with what's going on in the locker room than Patrick Kane getting hurt. I mean, they still got Jonathan Toews. They still got Duncan Keith. You know, they still got Vermette. Well, not Vermette. I don't know, whatever. What are you looking at? What are you looking behind you? All right, what's another story? I'm sick of talking about Patrick Kane already. Fuck Patrick Kane.
That's the only stories I got.
That's it? You don't got anything else? We got to be missing something. Fucking Dave Rose is going to give you a horrible review.
I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Is it because of the glasses?
I don't care. You're funny.
All right.
I love when you're around. You need to be around more often. I'm looking.
Yeah, but I have a feeling.
Now we go to the part of the what? Now we go to the part of the program. We go to the part of the program where let's play what the newsman missed. What do you think? You want to be that to be a yeah? What the newsman? Tony Barrasso, North Boston. You're on the air. Yeah. What the hell is wrong with you? What are you choking your chicken again?
Is he jerking off the fucking?
Oh no! What was that?
Oh no!
Mr. Roboto. Oh no! I don't know. See, I don't know if he's doing that on purpose or he's actually, you know.
Sounds like fucking alien porn.
Yeah, I had enough of it. Yeah, alien porn. That's hot. Call back if you want. I don't know. Let's play what he missed. Let's see. What time are we in? What time? We got a half an hour left. So yeah, we have time to play this game. What did Jeff miss? I told him to do this. You hear me? No, I guess Tony's a. I guess Tony's. No, I don't. No. Let's try to add him to group again. I kind of want to get Tony's opinion because he did have one of the greatest moments in this channel's history. So I have
some minor stuff if you want.
You had like, you know what it is? You did a really good job reading the news, and I would say a better job than Jeff reading the news because you actually have a full sentence. But you pick like the worst stories in the worst order. Jeff's better at that than you. Let's see if I can.
I took these stories from Jeff. He sent them to me
for
email.
Oh God, he sucks.
I like. All of a sudden, he just said, oh, I'm going to blame Jeff now.
Yeah. Oh, no, I'm sorry. I can't do that. Sorry. That was my fault. It's not Jeff.
Jeff, Tony Barrasso, yeah, you're on the air.
I'm a team player. Now?
Yeah, something was just a bad connection. What's on your mind?
My bad, man.
What's on your mind?
God damn, when's the last time I've been on here?
I don't know, but give me something to talk about, dopey.
The Bruins.
What do you want
to talk about? And how bad they're sucking right now.
Didn't they win the last three in a row?
Not now, but like just before this. Stop watching the Bruins because it was just terrible.
You stopped watching?
I started focusing on other teams.
You stopped watching? Why'd you stop watching?
No, just the Bruins because they were sucking.
Really?
And then I started watching other teams. I was starting to focus on more.
What a great
teams.
Fan you are. Why don't you support this? What was I going to do? You watched the game.
I wonder if there's a parade in June if you're going to watch some of it.
Oh, I bet you didn't miss Raw 1 week. Bet you didn't miss Cronin. I guess you love Cronin and Raw better more than you like... more than you like hockey. You know, the Boston Bruins.
It's actually about the same, but even. Really? But no, like I said, I haven't stopped watching hockey. I've just been watching more of the teams than just I mean, I've been watching a lot of other teams, but like I was mainly focused on the Bruins. But now it's just, eh. I mean, I'm
this
a
is your worst call ever, by the way, course, Tony. Tony, you have the most epic moment. This is definitely the worst. How does that make you feel?
Good.
Do you want me to? So here's the problem I have with this phone call, because I'm going to teach you how to make phone calls. All right, I'm teaching everybody right now. I'm glad you're here, Tony. You call or have a question or a statement. Either or is great. I don't even know. All right, the Bruins suck. Now what? What do I do now?
I laugh.
Do you want me to elaborate why I think the Bruins suck, or what I think is going to happen?
Go ahead. I want your opinion.
Do you really want my opinion?
Yes, I do.
If you want to, just want to hang out with us. Do you want to hang out with us?
Why not?
I'm not going to let you hang. I ain't Cronin. I'm a fucking dick. You ever hear that show? I fucking
go
made
ahead,
him break.
Nuke me if you want.
I made him. I made him break glass. It's all my fault. You know that. I made him break glass. And everybody said mean things in the fucking chat about me.
And he made a video about you, too.
Yeah, and apparently he claims I have a false apology to him.
Yeah, he said his dick is bigger than yours. What are you going to say about that?
I'm fucking Irish. Of course his dick is bigger. I have the Irish curse.
I think he is, too.
I mean, listen to your voice, man.
Yeah.
I mean, Jesus.
You want to see my dick? All right, listen. I'm glad you're here. I'm glad you're here, because I'm about to make a statement about the situation with the Joe Cronin show. I first want to come out. I want to also thank Benoit Claudieu, Frenchie Ben.
Chris?
Benoit. He's a friend of ours. He's a caller. Boy, you haven't called in a long time. You're right. I'm going to make a statement, Tony. I'm going to make a statement about the Joe Cronin incident. All right? I'm going to do it right now.
Yeah.
All right. To refresh Jake, we were having a discussion, if you want to call it that, about the recent FCC ruling with net neutrality. That conversation got unbelievably heated. And
I saw some of it on Facebook. All
right, it got out of control, and this is like the second time in the month it got really, really out of control. Both times I didn't see it coming, because to me it's just a political argument. I will admit that I am not 100% innocent in the whole thing. You know, I have a tendency to interrupt and be obnoxious. But what happened was Joe ended up breaking some glass, and you know, I mean, there was two reasons I hung up. I was a little sick of being called an idiot, but look, I can get over that. I got fucking broad shoulders. That was what the other reason was, and this is, it's going to sound condescending, but it's the absolute truth. I hung up because I didn't want things to get worse, and I didn't want anybody to get hurt, and that's why I hung up. And I also said that I wasn't going to be on the show anymore. After having some talks with Dave, I don't know if that's going to be the case. Certainly, if there's an incident like that again, I don't want people getting hurt. I don't want things to end. See, the thing is, I don't want people to get hurt, and I can't do a show about irreverent opinions and have to worry about glass breaking. From what I've been told, I've talked to Joe online. There was never, never a friendship issue, ever, and that seems to be what's going on in the Joe Cronin community. We had a fight. I just got off and removed myself the situation. During the show that he kept broadcasting, we typed back and forth. It was totally cultured. There was never any negative feel. There was no name calling. I removed myself from the situation, and I said, I quit monetize this, probably because of the showman side, right? I am not 100% innocent. Everybody knows that I interrupt all the time, you know, and I'm obnoxious. And I was basically doing the whole Tommy C thing there. What I didn't know, for the second time, it got absolutely out of control. I will never apologize for that, because that's simply not my fault, and I think everybody knows that. If you lose your mind because of something I say, I mean, with the possible exception of yelling the N-bomb, calling you the N-bomb, saying I fucked your mother, I don't think there is anything my opinion on the FCC should drive somebody to act in that way. I think Joe knows that. That being said, I threw fuel on the fire, being the fucking jerk off I can be, and I removed myself from the situation. There was never, at any time, I'm not your friend anymore. I'm not a part of Joe Cronin. I removed myself, and I've had some thoughts about monetize this because it hasn't been as fun. But from what I understand, there's going to be like efforts made to fix things. And I could only, one of the things we're going to make the announcement this week, I can only do monetize this once every 2 weeks. So I'm only going to be on 2 months as it was. So, and that had nothing to do with Joe or anybody. Joe, Leah, love him to death, wasn't angry, removed myself from the situation, because it's like this, like, and I'm not saying Joe's an alcoholic. If your friend's an alcoholic, it's not your fault if you hand him a drink and he goes and drinking and driving. But my moral code says, it's not your fault. It's his decision. And it was Joe's decision to break the class. But my moral code is, you don't bring the drinks to begin with. And I remove myself because I think of throwing fire. And it doesn't really matter whose fault it is, whether it's my fault. Certainly I contributed. And I will never apologize for what I said, because I believe absolutely what I said. And I was a little aggravated with myself that I got snarky. But you know, I think I got snarky because I'm getting a little sick of being called an idiot. And that's usually my rule. If you call me an idiot to open up the conversation, then I'm going to kind of give it back to you. And I didn't want to do that because we wanted to have like a normal conversation. So that's really what happened. I was never, to make it clear, I was never angry. Never angry. Not at all. I was never angry. I just threw myself in the situation. I don't apologize. I will never apologize. There's nothing to apologize for. But, you know, I mean, I probably should let people talk more and let them get a point across. But, I mean, that's nothing new. That's like that's not a new problem.
Yeah, who doesn't do that?
Yeah, sure. And I come off like the guy at the dinner party that brings up all the uncomfortable conversations that makes everybody fucking crazy. Well, here's the thing. I'm not that guy. I was in Boston. I was in that house. I went to family. We had dinners. None of that shit came up. It was normal. It was a normal conversation. But you're putting me on an opinion shows where I have a different opinion than 90% of the people from Massachusetts. And you can't, it can't be shocking when you hear it. I'm not saying, you know, the Jews control the entire country from a small village in Tel Aviv. I'm not saying crazy shit like that. I'm not saying throwing racist epithets out there. I'm not doing anything like that. Doesn't approach. So the reaction wasn't justified. I think Joe knows that. But at the same time, friends getting tiffs. And I take responsibility. It's the last thing I'm going to say. And then I take responsibility. I probably shouldn't have interrupted. But I shouldn't have interrupted fucking Matt today. I shouldn't have interrupted Deb today. I shouldn't have done it to Jake. But that's just kind of show we're done. It's supposed to be like off the cuff. So, I mean, yeah. So don't worry. What do you think of that?
Like I said before, like, who doesn't do that? I mean, it's something new. Our show, and it's nothing new, like in reality either.
And the other thing is, it's nothing to apologize for. It's just fact. I don't expect apologies. I'm not going to apologize. I don't think there's any point in Joe apologizing. I mean, if he has a problem with what he did, he's got to deal with it himself. I'm not mad. There's no issue here. You know, I never planned not to be a part of the Joe Cronin. I do stuff behind the scenes. I talk to him. We kind of bat ideas off each other. He's totally responsible for, he gave this station, this channel the rub. There's no doubt about that. There's no way I don't appreciate it. But I'll make an effort to tone down interrupting. I'll make a maybe tone down. I've been told that I come off as condescending sometimes. Yeah, it's true. I'm not condescending. I may get that way when somebody calls me a name. I want you to come on my show and fucking say whatever comes to your mind. And then things go nuts when I do that. So it's like, and I think everybody knows that. I think that everybody's knows.
Oh, you
that.
Know why I do.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Look, it's, I think the whole Cronin community, I'll be perfect. I don't care what they think. But this is the truth. It was this fucking silly incident. Is monetized this, going to exist again? Probably. I don't even think I refuse. If I'm not going to make any changes, we're not going to make any changes if we do go back to it. But I think at that moment, I got emotional, and I think it was still the best thing to do to get off, because I don't want anybody, I don't want to throw fuel on the fire.
You don't want Joe breaking more stuff.
I don't.
He almost broke his mic.
It's not my fault that he broke his mic. It's not my fault that he broke his window. It's not my fault he broke his window. I take no responsibility. Definitely. I don't take anything bad. I stand by absolutely everything I said, but I'm not going to fucking, if it hurts him, even though that's his problem, I'm not going to do it. I don't get off on that shit. You know, I don't take any joy in that. But, I mean, that's my statement. And, you know, I mean, if you don't buy it, you don't believe it, that's fine. There's no hate here. We're just going to let things blow over. We're going to talk about it, and everything's going to go back as normal. That's it. What are you laughing at? What else? Any trades happen?
I'm not. Deb just gave more info on the trade.
Let's hear that. What do you got?
And the Rangers, if she's right, I don't know if she's joking, but
wow,
The Rangers gave more. They gave more Duclair and a first round pick in 2016.
I don't like that at all.
Not Girardi. Like
not Girardi.
No.
Girardi didn't go at all. They gave away Duclair.
Yes, and that is way that. Too much.
So Girardi stays, Duclair goes, and a pick.
That's still too much.
Yeah.
And more. I think the more is I like more. Dominic Moore was like a, you know, he's a big player for
them. They saw something they didn't like in Duclair. That's what it tells me. So what round draft pick? Let's get this straight.
First in 2016.
Are you kidding me? Did we just give away our first round draft pick and fucking a hot prospect?
Yep.
Do you think he was maybe pissed that they sent him back to juniors?
Probably.
I don't think at his. I don't think I could be wrong. I don't think at his age he just has any fucking say or no one is really gives a shit what he thinks. He fucking made the team. That was shocking enough as it is when he made the team in October. That was shocking enough as it is. I'm pretty surprised.
Are you sure about this, Deb? Where did you find this?
That's crazy.
Yeah. She said, no, I'm not joking. It's real.
Wow.
I'm looking it up. That's
It hasn't come to the ticker yet. Hey, Tony, thanks for calling. I'm glad you kind of represent Joe Cronin in the story.
And I'm glad I can follow back up on hockey. Thanks, man.
All right. Goodbye, and keep your hands out of your pants. Bye. That was Tony in North Boston. And I hope the crony community is satisfied by my answer. Let's call Dave Rose. What do you think? Do you think, guys? Dave Rose. He came from Argentina, wherever the hell he was from. And he does point out Dave Rose. Dave Rose, where the hell are you, Dave Rose? Huh?
Hi, Dave.
Dave? Dave? Dave?
Hey, guys.
What do you got? Now it's time for the Rose review. What do you think, Dave?
What was that?
The Rose Report.
It's the Rose Review.
Rose
Report's on my YouTube channel.
Yes.
Review of the show.
Okay.
So, it was an interesting show. I'm not blaming Matt at all for the rating that I'm going to give it today.
I am.
It's a generous 7. It's a generous 7, and unfortunately, though, it was lacking in the usual chock full of hockey news type episode. But it's again understandable that Matt is new. Deb was also a little upset at the fact that Tommy are being a little hard on the guy. This is his second
fuck
show.
Fuck him, Jesus Christ!
But again, first of all, the guy sounds great. That new mic sounds awesome. It doesn't sound like he's underwater. Mm-hmm. And, you know, $10.99 sure beats spending $400 on a headset.
Yeah.
Hey, Jeff?
Yeah.
And to top it all off, he's doing it in a hotel room with shitty Wi-Fi.
Exactly. I mean, the guy's already out of country, so he's taking his, you know, computer with him. So I think it's a great job. And what Matt has been doing...
He's going to a desolate area, you know, that little small country called America.
You know what I thought. I think the 7's more than fair, by the way. If you said 6.5, 6.9, 6.9, I totally would have grasped it. I mean, it's like.
I initially was going to say 6.5, but I thought 7 again because, first of all, Matt made a great effort in doing today's show. He was able to pull out a lot of stuff.
I like the way
he read.
And
there was also other things in the show that made it boost up to that level because, you know, hockey info a little lacking, but there was quite a few good jokes, Matt, for example, being made fun of by Jake about wearing glasses, and he wears glasses.
Yeah, they can't all be winners.
But I got to say that Matt actually looks quite handsome.
He
there
does.
With those,
he's a good-looking
glasses.
Guy,
quite
right?
Dapper.
Does that make
I don't understand
gay?
How these stupid Quebecois frogs are saying, you know, are you a gay homosexual? They clearly have something wrong with their eyes because this man is a fucking model.
Beautiful man.
He could be one of these Qatari. Sheiks, for example. I mean,
why don't you take
Dave
Rose?
By a
why don't
lot
you take him to the park sometime when you're in
the... You should get one of those saris and start wearing them around. And then girls are like, oh my God, he has money.
But one thing, though, I do want to say, though, that there was some good hockey... Mm-hmm. news, not only with Deb's call talking about the Hawks, but also your discussion about the trades early on in the show. Yeah. And what obviously what I was interested was the Clarkson trade. And although Ben is saying that it's a good trade, I'm kind of siding with you, Tommy. Mm-hmm. But nonetheless, that entire discussion on the trades was a very good analysis, and I did appreciate that.
The trade discussion was pretty good.
So, yeah, basically, when I say a lot of good, great jokes from Jake, I'm not going to go through them all. And I like the fact that Matt was able to at least save the show, you know, by going back to the news and keeping the show, you know, steered towards the hockey discussion. But one thing I do want to quickly mention is the fact that tabs, I use tabs, and when I've done the news, buddy, I think I've done a bang up job, considering it's not my full time gig. But you want to skip to next tab, control tab on your keyboard. Instantly goes to the next tab, and you can cycle through. So learn how to use a computer, and
but you know what I'm talking about. You know what I'm talking about. You know what I'm talking about.
I'm not blaming you, buddy. You're a chemical engineer, or whatever you are. You know, you don't know computers.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, really, what would we expect?
But
that's scary if he's a chemical.
Last thing I do want to say. Last thing I do want to say is that I do like the fact that Matt was right on the ball when it comes to monetizing the monitoring the chat.
Yeah.
Because as soon as Deb got that scoop about the trade and stuff, he was right on it and got into it. So again, I think seven is a generous number. But again, Matt, I think you're the one that brought it up. And
he also brought it down and brought it up at the same time. That's what you're saying. He knocked it down to four and then dragged it back up to seven.
Well, if you really want to be honest, Tommy, I think you may have had a detrimental effect on the score.
My mind's other
things of a certain nature that I'd rather not speak about.
No, talk about it.
Forget about it.
That's not fun. Because I'm gonna ask you the question that you're trying to keep to yourself anyway. Because I think that's interesting.
I've got a beautiful window next to me. I don't want to break it. So.
Well, what did you think about my Cronin statement? I'll get you. Be honest.
Okay. Well, if we're really going to pull me into this discussion,
sure.
I do side a little more with you ideologically in regards to the discussion.
Yeah.
However, the manner that you came off in the show was very disrespectful, and it actually took away from the validity of your discussion.
I would agree with you.
Therefore, made you look worse, and made the argument, I should say, look worse than it should.
I would agree with you.
The way that it was being portrayed.
I think
you wrong? Nah, I would say I would side with you more than I would side with Leah and Joe. That being said, you did interrupt everyone throughout, as a few did other people, but that, like you said as well, we got to be honest here. Yeah. You're not in control of Joe's reactions or responses. So, you know, I understand where you're coming from.
I'll say this. And it's a simple fucking fight. I'm not trying to make a federal case of it, but it is a part of this community. There's no way not to talk about it. And I don't want to avoid the situation. I don't want to put you in the spot and sense what the thing is. And I think everybody, from what I hear, everybody pretty much has the same perspective. Did I come off as condescending prick too? I will defend myself one way. All right. I am, and maybe it's because of the ketchup, I am a little, I mean, here's the way I made my statement in the conversation. Look, Tommy, you're an idiot, and here's why. You know what? I'm a little sick of having with these discussions, and I do interrupt, and I do all those things, that have to take the high road, and it's not just Leah or Joe or anybody else. And as soon as I actually break it, which, by the way, this was probably the first time that I was
Joe's
like straight
in the chat
up.
Right now, he said, play my video.
Yeah, I was thinking about playing it. Yeah, sure, I will. Yeah, I'll do it. I'll play the video. I honestly think I am a little sticky. Like, there seems to be sort of a double standard for me that I have to keep this decorum, right? And I do. But I think everything's off once you're an idiot. Everything, that's it. And here's
either way, yeah. I'm just a fan, and watching both of you during that episode, watching everyone really during that episode, it saddened me, and
I thought it was
the least enjoyable episode of Monetize This, which is the reason why I decided to get involved.
But, oh, okay.
Again, steering back to hockey, you know, again, it is what it is. I think both of you did things wrong in your own way.
Sure.
Usually my strategy is two wrongs do make a right, but unfortunately in this case it did not. So
you know what?
Live and learn, buddy, and that's it. It is what it is.
I totally agree with you. The only thing I said, I am a little, I'm a little sick of having to hold up the end of the decorum when the conversation opens. You're a moron. Usually, under normal circumstances, once you're a moron comes out, the bets are off. And I think I finally got sick of it. And I knew the moment that I was snarky back to her that I broke my own rule. And I was like, wow, I'm really not having fun here. And then what happened. And I was like, look, I got to remove myself because of the situation. That being said, it's not that big a fucking deal, people. It's not the end of the fucking world. You never been in a fight with your friend? It's not the end of monetize. Well, I don't know. There might be have some adjustments made, but it's not the end of the relationship. It's not the end of anything. It's not the end of anything. It's not the end of anything. Unless somebody wants it to. But I think I'm still going to have some kind of impact. And I, from what I've been told, nobody's mad at me. And I got over it 15 minutes later. But it's like when so many people are listening, it's like an event. So, I mean, that's
no, but yeah. Here's another thing, though, Tommy, and I'm not going to tell you to live your life any which way. Mm-hmm. But sometimes the way that we act sometimes can be a little, problematic sometimes with our mannerisms. And when we sometimes, okay, I'm not blaming you for
just
anything.
I don't care what you say. I think all your criticism has been good. Relax and fucking just say it. I'm not jumping in your ass. I never do that. But go ahead.
Okay. Look, coming from one prick to another, because again, I'm the same way.
Problem.
I'm unrepentant. I stand up for my beliefs and I stand by them. But sometimes the way that you act with certain people might be considered condescending, aggravating and stuff. And if really what you're discussing is something that you really wish to discuss openly, fairly, and not only that, with a proper decorum, mm-hmm. you have to sort of adjust the manner that you say things and not only just speak in a different term or use different analogies, but also try to approach it from a different method to get your message across. But I think that it does an injustice to your, like, to the message that you're trying to say mm-hmm. when, you know, people are perceiving you, rightly or wrongly, you that you're trying to be condescending. So again, it could be a perception that some people say, oh, well, he's being an asshole. Well, maybe it's not, but maybe they're interpreting it in that way. And sometimes if the purpose of the discussion is for you to actually try to trade some information, to have a good debate and maybe make somebody realize something different than they normally would, sometimes you need to adjust your own manner of doing things to get that message across.
I would,
as foreign as difficult as that can sound, because I have that same issue sometimes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
sure. You know, it's like, why is this person not understanding something that I clearly understand? But okay, I'll explain things in a different manner and then maybe ask you questions to start make you pondering my side of the story. So it's just a matter of balance and trying to
I agree with you.
I guess do the dance. But anyway, I mean,
you're 100%,
I'm not holding you to any account. You did what you did. It is what it is. I'm not mad at you. I'm not happy at you.
Okay.
But that's the thing. It is what it is. What the fuck does my opinion have to do with it?
Well, no, your opinion counts because I asked you and it's important to me. But the only thing that I'll say to that, I think what you said is 100% true. I don't think I do anything. I don't think I help myself at all as far as, maybe trying to get a point across or making people understand or trying to teach them or anything like that. And there's a reason for that, because I'm not doing any of it. I am not changing a damn thing at all. I might try to lower the interrupting and the tone, but here's the thing. This is not a dinner party. This is not a college class. I think all those rules are thrown out of decorum are thrown out in a show like Monetize This. And if you don't like it and you don't like me, you're more than welcome to feel that way. And you know what? When Tommy C says something like that, he's absolute responsibility for all the hate and what have you getting. I don't care. It is not my problem that you don't get it. But
I respect that too. Yeah, I respect
don't
that you
care
stand by your position
and
that you take a stance.
That's
that,
it. I
you know,
don't
people
care.
Can shove
but
off
I'm own. Going to have to live with the fact that no matter if whether I'm right, 100% right, nobody's going to respect that opinion. But you know what? We're not at a dinner table. We're at Monetize This. And that's the way I see it. And that's where I'm going to end it.
It's like someone going on to the Howard Stern show and getting offended at wondering if they use a vibrator or if, you know, they fucked whores or something, you know? You guys get it.
Yeah.
Enough
talk
from Dave.
I think we get that. Do you want to listen to my apology?
Well, Joe did a video of that.
Yes,
so.
You want to see my apology? Here it is. Let's see if I can get this. Here it is.
Everybody expected wrestling talk here, but, you know, a lot of stuff went down the other day, but I do want to say that Tommy C has apologized to me in this. He wrote me this email, so I copied down all the points that he made here. Like, he wanted me to read this to you guys as his apology, I guess. I don't know. And I feel bad about what happened the other night. But it's good that he apologized, and I have his apology here. It's amazing that he even wrote this. I promise to never talk over Joe Cronin again. I promise to leave my tinfoil hat at home. Germany has made some bad decisions in history, and so have I. Cronin has a bigger dick than me. I owe all I have on YouTube to Joe. And honestly, I think I would have never met him, I'd be dead.
I sound like Tollbooth Willie.
Cronin smells like Old Spice.
Mm-hmm.
I smell like shit. Cronin sounds like a wannabe asshole. I am an asshole. If I could go back in time, I would have been a garbage man.
Actually, I'd be a garbage man now. That's not a joke.
Shot from the Point was all Joe Cronin's idea, not mine. Joe Cronin sends me food every month to feed me because I don't make enough money. And honestly, if I didn't have that food, I would starve to death. I'm a homeless cocksucker.
All right, the show just moved up to an 8.
With somebody else's material.
Went ahead and admitted everything right there on that email, but it was it's tough to read someone's brutal honesty. To be honest, it's a tough thing to read something like that. And
Tommy, listen,
I appreciate him for being honest and telling the truth, but I think it was unnecessary, and I'm a little embarrassed about the whole thing, to be honest. And I just hope that we can move on from this. But I accept your apology, Tommy.
Yeah, fuck you.
And, don't worry. I'll still keep sending the food.
Everybody, the great job, Cronin. So, I mean, if that doesn't prove to
Tommy,
anybody,
you're gonna start getting care packages.
That doesn't prove anybody that this. I mean, I can see the smile on your face. You feel better now, Dave Rose. You feel better, Dave Rose. Do you feel better about the whole thing after hearing that? I mean, I do. Makes me. I mean, I felt fine yesterday and even an hour and a half after the incident. But, you know, look.
I just wish it never happened.
Me too, but shit happens. And you know what? I'm living life, man. I'm not fucking looking back. Fuck that shit. Wasn't that big a mistake on my part?
Look, I'm not crying like Matt the other day. You know,
yeah,
I've been crying all day.
Yeah.
I'm literally crying.
it's all morning. Get it right.
Not a fucking big deal. Fucking in the world. I mean, I'll be perfectly honest with you. I mean, I flew to Boston to meet the guy and his family, and I think things went really well. We really enjoyed each other's company. What kind of fucking fragile, stupid, non-friendship would we have if we couldn't get through something like this? You know? And I don't care. From what I understand, I got a lot of heat on Cronin's channel. Hey, everybody on Cronin's fan team, fuck you! I don't care, you know? I'm sure that didn't help either, Rose. You know?
Frenchie Ben did say that's a great Tommy impression.
Yeah, it was. You too.
I said that too in the chat.
It was.
I start making fun of his
ass. I almost said, okay, boss.
Okay. All right, let me knock this out. Look at these three goofballs. Oh, wait, the co-host thing button isn't working. Oh, that's even working. Explicit acting funny. The guy on the left there is legendary Jake Link. Check him out at jakelinkcomedy.com. He's great. He's hireable. He's through all those things. And he lives in the East Coast in the tri-state area, New York area, whatever you want to call it. And the wonderful, great Matt Kazar, who was, I would say, better at reading the news, but picked all the worst stories in the worst order. Otherwise, he did a really good job, and he did bring the show up.
Yes, the other day, PK Subban did an icing.
And he's funny, and he's fun to make fun of, and it's a little easy, and he's a good guy. And then we, of course, we have Dave Rose,
fun for you guys,
star of the Dark Show, star of the Dark Show, Joe Cronin contributor, Chopping the Point contributor, valued team member. And I like the fact that he shoots straight and fucking honest. I don't care if you fucking hurt my feelings or not. You what kind of douchebag would I be if I brought you on and then tell you and didn't. You think it's a six, it's a six. I don't give a fuck. It's going on in the air next week.
Seriously, though, you actually stand up for free speech, whether you don't like the speech or not, and that is truly commendable.
Sure. And I don't think Joe feels the same way, by the way. We all have fucking bad days. Look. If that was the worst fucking thing I did in my life, but by the way, I've done a lot worse than what he's done. You know, it's just not that big a deal. It's just not that fucking big a deal. And it's who cares? What do I want to talk about? JohnFreeManMusic.com, JohnFreeManMusic.com. Please give JohnFreeManMusic.com. He writes the show for this show. This show, all shows. Well, he's the official point man musician. He does a fucking great job. We all appreciate what JohnFreeManMusic.com.
Tommy, Joe's trying to call in right now.
Is he? Oh, yeah. Really?
I put that in the Skype chat. I thought you'd see.
No, oh, he did.
I didn't want to interrupt
your
flow.
I'll call in fucking again because I was doing a million fucking things at the time, assuming.
While we wait for Joe, I want to quickly say that you had mentioned that there was some sort of difficulty with the band Border from Argentina.
Oh, I fucked that whole thing up.
I need to set these guys straight.
Oh, I fucked that whole thing up. No, I went by my high school Spanish. You're gonna laugh at this, and it said exploita, and I thought he meant exploit or stealing. And I wrote him back in Google Translated Spanish. Look, I'm not stealing fucking anything. So I said, I sent the message to the band. I said, look, you got this guy. His name's Spinelli or whatever the hell. He's fucking giving me shit. He's like, they're sending me the stuff. And they wrote me back. He said, they're like, dude, it's a misunderstanding. He means exploit as explosion. Like, you're a fucking rock and roll badass. And I'm like, oh my God, I'm an idiot. It was their bass player. They're just saying hello. And you guys rock. And like, fuck yeah in Spanish. And I took it as fuck you. And I heard you're stealing. I took it as you're stealing. It was just a language.
I'm just curious. What does your foot taste like?
Well, a lot worse than that than it did in the Cronin thing. I tell you that. It felt worse on that one.
Tommy's batting an O for this week.
Yeah, I'm doing too good right now. But I did. He just, it was really funny, and so he laughed at it. I wrote back, I was embarrassed. But it said exploita, and I thought it was explode. And it did kind of translate to steal, you know, in the Google Translate. And then there was like a bunch of profanity. But it was more like, fuck yeah, you guys rock. And I just took it as, fuck you guys suck. You know, that's what happened. But big shout out to Border. They're fucking great, and we really appreciate the song and In the Crease of Tommy Sing. How's that?
That was awesome.
Why am I forgetting all these fucking plugs? Matt, you gonna be around tomorrow? Are we doing the show? So I can plug that shit?
Absolutely.
All right. That's fucking great. Do I have that fucking ad? Yeah, that's In the Crease of Tommy C, 4:30 Eastern Standard Time. Live! 4:30 Eastern Standard Time, live. We do the day in hockey. I'm pretty sure it's gonna go air, but if not, if Shot from the Point Radio, if it's just easier to stay alive with Shot from the Point Radio, we'll just do that with the commercial music because we're going to be covering the trade deadline and all that other stuff. So, stay tuned for Shot from the Point Radio, which we're going to do, and stay tuned for In the Crease with Tommy C. It'll probably all be wrapped up by then anyway, and maybe we'll just finish it there. So I'm going to keep real close track to what's going on in the trades, and we're going to talk about them, and anybody's welcome on. And then we're going to be spinning tunes and doing our thing. Mine and breaking windows. I don't fucking know. All right. I think that's it. I'm tired. I don't know about you guys. Yes? No?
Yeah.
Yeah. And big apology to the Border guys. I fucked that up. I am bouting fucking over 2 this week. There's no goddamn doubt about it.
Don't worry. I'll work as his personal translator from now on.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, sure. Okay, here's the deal. Thank you very much for listening to Shot from the Point Live and all that other good shit. Hope you listen in the Crease. Hope you like the videos. Hope you stay tuned for the trade deadline. Shot from the Point Radio introduction tomorrow. Really appreciate you being there. We really appreciate the increase in subs. And I take this out to Boston. Joe Cronin, we love you. We always will. And we always appreciate what you've done for this show. And don't worry about it. You fucking jerk. Ah!
We'll be right back.